The relationship between Sri Lanka and Egypt goes back many centuries. In episode 2, we saw how one of the first known maps showing Sri Lanka, also called the Map of Taprobana, was drawn by the Greco-Egyptian geographer Ptolemy in the 2nd century AD. We saw how Ptolemy's world map prominently showed Sri Lanka in the center. And we also saw how Ptolemy had named a river in his map of Sri Lanka as Soana Fluvius, or River of the Arabs. In this episode, we focus on an incident that took place in the 13th century that involved the Muslims of Sri Lanka and how the then reigning king employed their diplomatic skills and sent a group of them to Egypt on his behalf. This king was King Bhuvanekabahu I of Yapahua, who ruled from 1271 to 1283 AD. Sri Lanka's interactions with Africa are as old as the country's history. Sri Lanka welcomed frequent visitors from Africa in ancient times, including at the royal courts. Some of the visitors settled down in Sri Lanka, and descendants of these early settlers still live in Sri Lanka today. These are distinctive communities concentrated mainly in areas such as Sirambiadiya, Trincomalee, Batticalo, and Nikambo. They try to preserve their unique culture through their cuisine and particularly their music. Their contribution to the Sri Lankan culture is indelible and part of our proud diversity. The Mahavamsa, the recorded chronicle of Sri Lankan history, states that King Bhuvanekabahu I sent several envoys to the Sultan of Egypt in Africa. This is also mentioned in contemporaneous Egyptian chronicles. Muslim traders were pivotal for the trade ties between Sri Lanka and Egypt. It was the Arabs who called our country Serendib, and it was from this name of our country that the word serendipity sprung. The meaning of serendipity therefore resembles what might have been the delight of the Arab traders when they sighted this country from their ships. Serendipity means a sudden, unexpected discovery that gives one great joy in a beneficial way. The Arab predecessors of the Moors, being experts in maritime commerce, were deemed the best suited for diplomatic missions in the pre-colonial period, and one of the earliest notices of a Muslim ambassador representing the Sri Lankan sovereign is found in an account relating to a Sri Lankan embassy sent to the court of Egypt in 1283. To narrate that story, one must be aware of a few things. By the end of the 13th century, a series of interconnected events which originated elsewhere had their repercussions in Sri Lanka, resulting in strengthening existing links between the Sinhalese and Muslims. The downfall of Polonnaruwa in the 13th century and the South Indian invasions of Sri Lanka saw the shifting of Sri Lanka's political capital to the southwest of the island. Also, the economic transition from an exclusively rice-growing economy to an export-oriented one were some of the major changes that took place in the pattern of trade in the Indian Ocean. And as a result, the trade of Sri Lanka was badly affected. This increased the dependence of the Sinhala rulers on the Muslims because trade, now a national priority, was in their hands. The Moorish community was undoubtedly both prosperous and powerful during the period of chaos and disintegration that overtook the Sinhalese civilization after the drift to the southwest in the wet zone. In this tussle, Muslims became the natural allies of the Sinhala kings. it is clear from the evidence at our disposal that right throughout, from the Anuradhapura period to Candian times, there was a Muslim lobby operating in the king's court. It was responsible for persuading the king to act, not only regarding matters of religious and cultural interest to the Islamic community, but also advised the king on overseas trade policies. Above all, the Muslims kept the country informed of developments abroad. Hence, the Muslim trader, with his navigational skills and overseas contacts, became the secret channel of communication between the court and the outside world. It is in this context that one has to view the diplomatic mission of Bhuvanekabahu I to the King of Egypt, Al-Mansur Kalawun, in 1283 AD. Sri Lankan Muslim of that time, Al-Hajj Abu Uthman, was chosen to lead the group of diplomats representing the Sri Lankan king. This mission was highly likely undertaken as an attempt to restore the flagging economy and enhance the political prestige of the country by establishing direct relations with Egypt, which had by this time superseded Baghdad. The king's delegation traveled by sea to the head of the Persian Gulf and then by land to Cairo through Baghdad and the Syrian deserts. According to Abu Uthman and his group of diplomats, they had embarked on a Ceylon vessel and came to the port of Hormuz, where they stayed 10 days. They then went up the Persian Gulf and, passing Basra and Wasit, came to Baghdad, then under the rule of Persian Mongols. The ambassador, having been admitted into the Sultan's presence, presented a letter which he said had been written by his master's hand. It was enclosed in a gold box and wrapped up in some stuff resembling tooze, the inner bark of a tree, which was made, it was said, from the bark of a palm. As no one could be found in the court of the Egyptian king to read the letter, its contents were explained by the ambassador as follows. Ceylon is Egypt and Egypt is Ceylon. I desire that an Egyptian ambassador accompany mine on his return and that another be sent to reside in the town of Aden. I possess a prodigious quantity of pearls and precious stones of every kind. I have vessels, elephants, muslins, and other stuff, wood of bakam, cinnamon, and all the objects of commerce which are brought to you by the Benian merchants. My kingdom produces trees, the wood of which is fit for making spears. If the Sultan asks me for 20 vessels yearly, I shall be in a position to supply them. Further, the merchants of his dominion can with all freedom come to trade in my kingdom. I possess 27 castles, of which the treasuries are filled with precious stones of all kinds. The pearl fisheries are part of my dominion, and all that is taken therefrom belongs to me. From this letter, we learn that the King of Sri Lanka was proposing to the Sultan of Egypt that he was willing to supply all kinds of riches and wealth directly to Egypt for engagement in trade. We see the proof of these links with Egypt even to this day. A number of Muslim coins of the 13th century were found between Colombo and Kandy. Among them, the greater number belongs to the Sultan Kalawun of Egypt, the king to whom Bhuvanekabahu I sent his envoys. In addition, a recent find of 4 Sri Lankan coins, the last of which belongs to Bhuvanekabahu I, were discovered at Mogadishu in Africa. Further confirmation that Muslims of yore were employed by the kings as diplomats to other nations is the fact that there are a few Muslim families in the Kandyan areas today who have the family name Tana Patila Gegedara, which literally means belonging to the house of the ambassador. Since these family names often indicate profession and official status, it is possible that their ancestors served as an ambassador. It follows that the Muslims played a significant role in the foreign relations of Sri Lanka. Their linguistic fluency, international links, and the internationalism of the Islamic faith had made the Muslims particularly adroit at diplomacy. Interestingly, the classical Sinhala term for Egypt, Misaraya, used to this day is of Arabic origin, deriving as it does from the Arabic word Misr, which is even employed in the Quran to mean Egypt. The usage may perhaps be a legacy of the country's former diplomatic relations with Egypt.